Okay, thank you. I hope it works out. Yes, it's called, the title of the sermon is hashtag YOLO. Do you guys know what that means? Are you sure we're only going to live once? I'm not going to live once only. I may die, but I'm going to live again, and I'm not going to die after that. So, actually, this expression is very common to millennials. Do you know who the millennials are? If you don't know who the millennials are, I'm going to give you a hint. I probably know what when you were born. Because these are the generations. So if you were born around this year, you are the World War II generation. I am happy to say that I'm a millennial. So all the millennials, but this sermon is not exclusively for us millennials because our Father is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. So whether you were born first or born later, we're all gonna learn something from this message today. So, YOLO, the millennials use it a lot, but not in a good way, unfortunately. They use it as an excuse to do bad things. It's like you're only gonna live once. Go drink and be merry, for tomorrow you'll die. But as Christians, we counter the culture, right? We don't go as the world goes. We counter it. Amen. We go against the flow. Amen. So, our YOLO means this one. You ought to look out. So, here's how I imagine God when God talks to me, because I'm a millennial. It's not like, thus said the Lord, Pearl, thou shalt not. The voice of God in my head is not like that. Instead, it's like, Pearl, hashtag YOLO, you ought to look out. Be careful of what you do. And God is speaking to me in such a way, don't let the excitement of your youth cause you to forget your Creator. Honor Him in your youth before you grow old and say, well, life is not pleasant anymore. So, I hope you guys born not in our generation, I hope you do not feel this way. Okay? Because there is no reason for a believer to feel this way. Amen. So, all of us are given by God 525,600 minutes. All of us. Our life in a year. God is really fair because He has given all of us, whether you're Generation X or World War or the Silent Generation, we all have 525,600 minutes in a year. So how we use that is up to us. You know, the Bible says the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And unfortunately, you know, we are very conscious about other blatant sins. It's like, hey, thou shalt not kill. But how do we spend our time is also something that we have to consider, right? It's not like a, you know, like we feel like it's not a horrible, horrible sin, but how we spend our time is so important to God. Why? Because He has given us a limited time. He has redeemed us so that we can redeem our time here on earth. And we have to use it, we have to see our time the same way that God sees it. So, we're going to jump on our verse today. This is a little small, so but please try to read together with me. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs of the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. So, I pray that God opens our heart today and as we learn all these things together. So I would like to start by dividing this verse into 7 parts so that we all understand it together. And as we go through all the 7 parts of these verses, please, like you know, as usual, let us examine our hearts. Please do not look at me and how I spend my time, or I'm not going to look at you too. So let's all check our hearts and ask the Lord to point where we need to repent on how we manage our time. So, first one, therefore be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise. So, walking in the Bible is, when Paul used this illustration to walk and then be careful, it tells us a lot of things, right? When we walk, it has to be a deliberate action, like we have to have a direction. How do we walk? And then in the Bible, there is said many times that you have to walk in the Spirit. And you know, if you come to our Sabbath school, you are probably learning more and more about the Spirit. So be careful how you walk. We have to walk in the Spirit. And the second part is not as unwise men, but as wise. The Bible also talks about always 2 kinds of people. Not many kinds of people. Like, there's always only 2 kinds of people. Because in God's eyes, I think there's only 2 kinds, right? There's no middle ground. So if you're not on fire for the Lord, you're what? You're cold. Don't think that you're hot, okay? So there's no middle ground. And also, we can see here, unwise and wise. Let's define what these are. So 1 Corinthians 9:24-27 says, "Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win." We don't come to become Christians just to lose, to be defeated by the enemy. We have to run in such a way that we have a goal, we have a direction, that we're going to live a victorious life. Right? And everyone who competes in the games exercises what? Self-control in all things. So one of the fruits of the Spirit is, guess what? Self-control. So if we are walking in the Spirit, we have self-control. And the verse is telling us that in these last days, self-control is going to be so important to us. So then they do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. Our reward after we finish the race, after we become victorious, is eternal life. God said in heaven, our possessions are not going to be stolen, they're not going to be eaten by moths, or they're not going to perish. So therefore, I run in such a way, not as without aim. So when we think of our time, we have to be intentional. We have to be very careful on how we spend our days, our minutes. I box in such a way as not beating the air. So, you see, this is an illustration of not hitting the air. Like, and of course, if you hit the air, you're not going to hit anything, right? You're just missing all over the place. So, but I buffet my body and make it my slave. We control, right? The flesh should be under the submission. Controlled by the Spirit. Lest possibly, after I have preached to others, I myself should be disqualified. Now, this is the saddest part, because we have come a long way, right? And then, if we do not discipline ourselves, and we fail at one thing, and then we get disqualified, it's such a waste. Like our whole lives, all the times we came to church and become a part of the church, and we learn from, you know, great people. And if we're going to get disqualified in the end, it's very, very sad. So we need to really run in such a way that we have an aim, we have a goal. So I hope as we start the year, it's only like, what, 49 days into the year, so we still have time. Lord willing, we still have time. So let us be intentional. Run in such a way that we win. So, There's another verse, interesting verse in 1 Corinthians 1:18 to 25. Because we talked about who are the wise people and who are the unwise people. Because the world, there are so many intelligent people in the world. And sometimes we get embarrassed because the intelligent people, they're not believers. They're not Christians. But there's an explanation for that. Paul says here, "For the word of the cross is to those who are perishing foolishness. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the cleverness of the clever I will set aside. Where is the wise man? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the word through its wisdom did not come to know God, God was well pleased through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For indeed, Jews ask for signs and Greeks search for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, to Jews and a stumbling block, and to Gentiles foolishness. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than man, and the weakness of God is stronger than man." So here we have to be discerning. Like there are so many kinds of information outside. It's like, okay, here's how to use your time effectively. They offer like a 10-step program for you to make your life efficient and fruitful. But God said, we need to understand that the worldly wisdom is not coming from God. So we need to have that discernment that we don't believe everything that we see, that everything people offers us. We need to see if it is in line with God's wisdom. And later we're going to go back to this. But number two, making the most of your time because the days are evil. So this is a different translation, but in some other translation it says, redeem your time, or redeem the time, because the days are evil. And I did a little study about that word, and it turned out to be a business word, like a marketplace word. Redeem means you gotta buy it, okay? So if you imagine merchants who are waking up early in the morning, like in the Philippines, the marketplaces in the Philippines, if you want to get the best vegetables and fruits, you got to go to the midnight market. Like they come either like 3 a.m. or things like that. So you seize every opportunity because the days are evil. So what does it mean that the days are evil? I don't know if you agree with me, but when we open our television, we hear all evil. When you open Facebook, you see all evil. You are searching about something so innocently, and you know, you see corrupted things. Mm-hmm. And people are just posting all evil. And I don't know about you, but I have quit Facebook a long time ago. And it's just evil all over the place. So what do we do? What do we do? Do we isolate ourselves? How are we going to counter the culture? So, if we see this one, the Lord says in the Bible, you overcome evil with good. So, I thought, like, maybe Christians should abuse the technology for the glory of God.
Amen.
Like, we use blogs. Dave and I have a podcast. So, like, things like that, places that we can't reach. The song says, I can't reach everybody, I can't help everybody, but who I can reach, I can reach. So instead of posting all evil, maybe we can post something nicer that would make people smile or edify them, encourage them, and things like this. And number three, so then, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. When I was studying about this, and when this topic was put by God in my heart, I wonder, How do we do this? How do we understand the will of the Lord is? And then I came to a part of the study that says, if you are not living in the will of God, you're just wasting your time. I'm sorry to say, but that's how it is. If you are not living in the will of God, you are wasting your time, you are wasting your life. So how do we understand? The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. There are so many things that are going to happen to our lives throughout the year that we may lack in wisdom. We don't know what we're going to do with those things that are going to happen to us. So what we do is we strive to know the Lord so that we can gain understanding. I find some people, this is what I try to do too. When God is speaking in the Bible, I try to personalize it sometimes. I put my name on it, and I try to imagine as if it was God actually speaking the word to me personally, so that I can claim it and I can put the scriptures in my head that, for example, God has not given you the spirit of fear, so you got to be bold and things like that. The fear of the Lord is what we need to have. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So this is what separates the wise from the unwise. The knowledge of the Holy One and the fear of the Lord. So when people just use fear to control other people. And fear is, it's like a big business, actually. If you come to think of it and you come to the root of it, everything, almost everything in the business world is backed by fear. Mm-hmm. Fear of not being recognized. Fear of getting old, so you gotta look young. Fear of this and that. So much fear. But we don't need that kind of fear. Mm-hmm. All we have to do is we try to know God. See, it's not that complicated. Even if you don't understand a lot of things in this sermon, if you're just visiting or you're new, all you have to do is your next easy first step is just know God. It's that simple. Know God, because the knowledge of the Holy One will lead you to understanding. And then number four, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation. You know, this is a difficult word for me because I'm not a native English speaker. So, dissipation, what does it mean? I research, okay, I'm just testing. I research for this. But be filled with the Spirit. Dissipation is like putting energy into something and it's just wasted. Dissipate. So, if you study the Bible and the Spirit, the Holy Spirit and wine, it's always contrasting. You can't be controlled by one and also be controlled by the other. So if you're being controlled by wine, you're not under the control of the Holy Spirit. It's only one. There's only one ruling power in a person's life. So this is a strong message for us because this is wasting time. Wasting time, the time that you can't get back anymore. A lot of, you know, the older generations, the Generation X, Silent Generations, Baby Boomers, they have lots of regrets because of dissipation, of wasted time, wasted opportunity. So let's strive to be filled with the Spirit and not get drunk with wine. Here we have Colossians. Can we read together? And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ richly dwell within you, with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another, with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. So, this morning at Sabbath school, we talked about the fruit of the Spirit, which is, one of them is peace, right? It's not possible for us to find peace. And we're going to need that a lot. Like, you know, if you're reading the news, if you're seeing all that is evil, hearing all that is evil that is going around, you're going to need a lot of peace. And the peace that God's give us is the peace that passes all, surpasses all understanding. But we can't have peace if we are not filled with the Holy Spirit, right? It's false peace. That's not going to be enough. That's not going to be enough to sustain us. When the world goes crazy and people are going crazy and we don't have peace, where do we run? We need to keep filling, right? Filling with the Holy Spirit. So, there's one thing that I also saw in here, like, let the word of Christ richly dwell within you, and with all wisdom, teaching, and admonishing one another. You know, this is very important. At the beginning of our study today, we saw different kinds of generations, right? There's so much wisdom from the older generations that us young people can get from them. So when an older person in church says, hey, you know, gives us advice or counsel, I think we should receive it wholeheartedly because they've been there. They've lived the days that we haven't lived. And sometimes we are probably not going to live up to that age to learn that. And so we need to make the most of it. We got to be thankful if people are mentoring us or teaching us to do this and that, because, you know, this is what the Lord wants, that we provide teaching and admonishing one another. So not only with, you know, advice, whether it's practical or not, but also with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. So singing is also an important part of our worship, singing with thankfulness in our hearts. So speaking of singing, let's move on to the fifth part. Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing, making melody with your heart to the Lord. Instead of wasting our time, like, singing worldly songs or whatever that keeps us depressed, we should sing spiritual songs and speak to one another instead of, like, you know, I don't know if you have been tired of hanging out with people and, you know, the conversation is actually leading nowhere. And at the end of the day, you were like, oh my gosh, what happened to my time? I wasted 300 minutes, like that, something like that, of my time. Especially, like, you know, when people spend time with you, they are giving you something that they can't get back anymore. So let's appreciate, let's not look on our phones. And when they're there, let's look at them and, you know, listen to them attentively. God is always telling us to sing. So, like, you know, it would be nice. I can't sing. That's why I'm here giving the sermon, because I can't sing. But that should not stop us to make melody with our heart for the Lord. And this is just something that I think, you know, we should understand when it comes to singing. Our church love hymns, right? Love hymns, but there are also so many songs, like, Spirit lead me where my trust is without borders, like, oceans. So much, yes, oceans, brother Seth's favorite. But, you know, there are so many uplifting songs, so I hope we do not limit ourselves, because, like, you know, God is a creator and he keeps creating things, new things. So that doesn't mean that all new songs are bad and not suitable for our worship, because it says, this verse, I remember, he said to them, you are the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of others, but God knows your heart. what people value highly is detestable in God's sight. So what does this verse teaches us is that when we worship and we have a song in our hearts, let's not suppress the song that God has put in our hearts, especially if it is encouraging to us, just because, you know, it's not the traditional, extremely traditional kind of way of worship. So, number six, always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to God, even the Father. So this is a little bit hard, all things, because like we said, not everything that happens to us is good. How can you say thank you for not having a job or losing your house or things like that? But Romans 5:3-5. Everybody, let's read. Not only so, but also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. So, see, there's a reason. There's a purpose for our disappointments, our sufferings, and we should not forget that, because it's character building, and we should be grateful. I actually, like, looking back in my life, if you know all the things that have happened to me, maybe I would not be here if not for the sufferings that I've had to endure. Amen. So God is good. And number seven, and be subject to one another in the fear of Christ. Now, this is sometimes, you know, we think, okay, you know, we follow authority. But if we are really serious about finding out like this, that how God is submissive, you'll be like so amazed how humble God is and how He humbled Himself. So this is the verse. Sorry, it's small. But I'm going to read this for you. Generation X and baby boomers, I'm going to read this for you. Therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort provided by love, any fellowship in the Spirit, any affection or mercy, complete my joy and be of the same mind by having the same love, being united in the Spirit, and having one purpose. Instead of being motivated by selfish ambition or vanity, each of you should, in humility, be moved to treat one another as more important than yourself. Each of you should be concerned not only about your own interests, but about the interests of others as well. You should have the same attitude toward one another as Christ Jesus had, that though He existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be grasped, but He emptied Himself by taking on the form of a slave, by looking like other men, and by sharing in human nature. He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that sufferings produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has given to us. So here, sometimes when we use our time, we wanted it to ourselves. Honestly, I have a confession to make. I have 5 planners every year. I have 5 planners. But I still, you know, manage to spend time with people and my friends, because we need to follow this rule. Like, when other people need our help, we need to be available to them. But that doesn't mean we don't have directions and we don't have boundaries. You see, before I had 5 planners, I usually just say yes. When people ask me, hey, can you help me? Yes, I'll be there, like that. Or, hey, let's meet, let's hang out. And yes, I'll be there. But then I realized I've been wasting my time. Like, I go back to my apartment, oh my gosh, all the things that I need to clean up. because I have many friends. So if you invited me and I said sorry to you, please don't get mad at me because I have 10 other friends who are inviting me. Something like that. And before, I didn't have proper boundaries. I just said, well, God said you're more important than my time, so I'm going to go. And I just realized that God also gives us common sense and boundaries, right? And I was like, oh my gosh, where did my money go? Oh, I had dinner last night, and I had coffee, and I had, and things like that. Boundaryless life. And it my time was a mess, and everything was a mess. So when we get invited or things like that, yes, we should be concerned about other people's interests. But now I have learned to give budget my time accordingly, so that, like, you know, who I can reach, I can reach. But I can't reach everybody. So it's a pretty good message. So anyway, now what? What are we going to do with this sermon topic? We need to have lunch. So what we're going to do is, how do we apply this? What's God trying to tell us? Romans 13, 11 to 14. And do this, understanding the present time, now. Now, the hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because your salvation is nearer now than when you first believed. So in former generations, we say, oh, Christ is coming. Like, you know, the earth is going to go crazy first before Christ comes. And it's now. It's the present time. So our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. So now is not the time to relax and take it easy. But we have to redeem our time to grasp and seize every opportunity that God has presented to us. The night is nearly over and the day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. So slowly, little by little, like, you know, we're getting transformed daily. Putting away something bad, putting on the armor of light, and slowly moving as we keep walking in the Spirit. Let us behave decently as in daytime, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality or debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh. When we manage our time this year, let's have a goal, let's have an aim. Let's seize every opportunity because now is the present time. And now is not the time for us to relax and take it easy and enjoy the cherry blossoms just for fun. We have to be intentional because we don't know. See, the day is almost here. We don't know if it's tomorrow or the day after tomorrow. So the opportunity that is now ours to speak to some needy soul, the word of life may never offer again. So if you're here visiting us, we have a pastor here. If you want to know Christ, please talk to our pastor. I have to say this because this may be an opportunity that you never, that may not be offered to you again. God may say to that one, this night thy soul shall be required of thee, and through our neglect he or she may not be ready. So in the great judgment day, how shall we render our account to God? So we need to really check ourselves, examine ourselves, and repent of our sins. Like Pastor was talking about last week, it's, you know, you put it away. You don't go back. You have to leave it. Why? Because we don't know. Actually, of course, with good intentions, I wanted to say that all of us are going to live a long, happy life. But we don't know if you leave this building and, God forbid, something happens to you. I'm not scaring you, but I'm just seizing the opportunity to tell you that now is the time, not tomorrow, not next week. So if you want to follow Christ, you got to decide now. Because God said there are only two people. It's the wise and the unwise. If you ended up being in the unwise section, the Lord can't do anything anymore. So Now is the time, our time to labor for the salvation of others. Now, while we're here in Japan, while we're doing our jobs, is the time for us to labor. If we're not just here to get money or something like that. There are some things that they may give money for the cause of Christ. This is all that they are required to do. The precious time which might do personal service for him passes unimproved. But it is the privilege and duty of all who have health and strength to render to God active service. All are to labor in winning souls to Christ.
Amen.
So not only pastor and pastor's wife. No, all of us are to labor in winning souls for Christ. Donations of money are good. We accept donations and offerings. But it cannot take place of this. Okay, if you want to donate, let us know. So, this is something that our small groups are doing. So, we have a small group, if you want to join. To make the most of our time, we choose one word. So, here, some of the words of us here. We chose one word. This one word is how we hope God would transform us throughout the year. This is like our lens. So, Kaka picked enjoy because she said the joy of the Lord is her strength. So, throughout the year, when she thinks about the Lord's plans in her life, this is what the lens that she is using. So, I can't share a lot of things to you because I'm just a millennial. I was just born recently. But this one word seemed to be very effective. Like, I've been doing this in the past couple of years with Dave as well. And if you choose a word, you can see how God worked in your life from the beginning to the end. Last year, my word was invade. And I felt like God lifted my spirit and made me invade all my fears. Well, not maybe not all. Sorry. Some of my fears. Biggest fears. So please, choose a word. And finally, redeem the time. Right now, we still have 316 days left towards the end of the year. If the Lord will grant all of us 316 days, okay? I can't guarantee that. But YOLO, everyone. Thank you.
Amen. Amen.